Their new season, they roll inside out, starts a new journey. Whoa. To the wild. This arrow pierces your body and the poison paralyzes you.
Oh.
The untamable. The bull has burst through. I didn't even notice climbing that tree. They're shocking. He's just sitting there eating a raw monkey. Ecuador. We will travel to the most inaccessible lands. To reveal the cruel mysteries of the wild tribes. Is the murder still normal nowadays? I just stabbed him, it's all. To test ourselves at the volcano slopes. It's important not to miss the right moment before it's too late. To challenge the stereotypes together with a unique model. Are you ready? Yes, we'll be at each other's side. And to understand more about the life in the country where the line between the good and the evil is blurred. Oh my God, it's real, I'm holding a human head. Welcome to the bright, contrastive and crazy Ecuador. Inside Out with Dmytro Komarov, Ecuador. My dear friends, the world Inside Out starts a new and dangerous expedition in a search of the wild tribes. This time in Ecuador, one of the most cruel Indian tribes in the world lives just here. The Huaorani. This tribe still kills the strangers who come to their land. A man was killed here, on the back. We didn't care who they were, we just killed them, that's all. We'll find out how many people were attacked by the Indians. I killed about 20 people. This bear was in my son's body. We'll find the people who survived. They pursued my husband with a spear and held him. I managed to jump into the boat, start the engine and escape. We'll travel a dangerous path to the most remote corners of Ecuadorian Amazonia. We spent 2 days in this boat already. That's how we spent the night in the jungle. There are people out there who can attack us. We're doing it to learn more about the shocking traditions and the unique rituals of the Huaorani tribe. Agua! Agua! We'll learn more about the life of the people who lived in the remote forest 50 years ago. It's fallen. Look, it has fallen. Why are we kissing the tree? Won't your wife get angry if I touch you? She'll forgive. We'll see the wild tribes mastering the modern technologies. Look, it's a rotor. A way to communicate with each other. Do you usually live like this or like this? And find out why the Indians regret making contact with a civilization. Did you miss the real adventures? The expedition is about to start. Let's fly! We'll need to go to Amazonia to find Huaorani. This huge area occupies one-third of the continent of South America and is situated on the territory of 9 countries. We've already studied Amazonia during our Brazilian season. Now we've come to its Ecuadorian part. There are only tributaries of the Amazon River here, not the river itself. This area hides many unfathomable secrets. There are endless impenetrable forests which are home to the thousands of species of wild animals and birds. But the real masters of this land are Indians, who are hiding from the outer world in the jungle in small groups, not letting the strangers near. Our expedition to Ecuadorian Amazonia starts from the city of Coca. Since the expedition is going to be very complicated, we will need a super professional guide. And not just a guide, he has to be from the tribe we are planning to visit, the Huaorani tribe. We'll need guides who know their way around the Amazonian jungle, where their tribe lives. These guides must understand which areas are the most dangerous and how not to become a victim of the non-contact tribes. They're already waiting. Buenos dias. Vopani. Vopani. Vopani, does it mean hello in Huaorani language? Yes. I'm Miguel. I'm Dima, and you? Gintotega. Ginto and Miguel are the father and the son from the Huaorani tribe. They will be our guides during the expedition. You don't look like Indians anymore. You have modern clothes. He says, Juventus. The son translates to his father from Spanish into the language of the tribe, as the father doesn't speak Spanish. Yes, I like football. But we have another aim today. We are going to meet one of the most, and even looking at these people, I will repeat it, one of the most dangerous tribes on our planet. Please confirm my words. Yes, that's true. We might look like the city people now, but our ancestors were strong and brave warriors who attacked the cities often. Even Coca was attacked by the Huaorani twice. Why did they attack? So the cities wouldn't grow and invade our jungle. Looks like nowadays our people live both in the forest and in the city. Yes, I study in Coca to be a lawyer. I want to defend my people on the legislative level. We have different concepts of the law. In our culture, there's the freedom of self-expression, entertainment, and the freedom of murder. For example, if someone offends me, I can take a revenge and kill him. It's normal for us, but not for the modern world. So young people study the laws to try to unite these two worlds somehow. So the blood revenge still exists. Yes, it still happens in our culture. Our ancestors killed people. It happens more rarely nowadays, but the blood revenge still takes place. You promised to show me the real Huaorani and tell what they are like, why they are so dangerous, and what makes them different from all the other tribes of the world. Yes, we'll go to our village tomorrow. It'll take us not less than 2 days to get there. It depends on the water level. But I have to warn you, Bameno, the place where we're going, is surrounded by the non-contact tribes' territories. We'll go through their wilderness areas where they can attack us. Non-contact tribes are the low-numbered people who still live in isolation of the modern world nowadays, just like their ancestors. They deny any attempts to contact the civilization and kill anyone who steps on their grounds. It happens not only in Ecuador. Last year, a non-contact tribe in Brazil has killed a human rights advocate of the indigenous people. And in 2018, in India, the Sentinelese tribe has killed an American with a bow. In 2015, the isolated Manchupira tribe has attacked a village in Peru. But the most reports about the non-contact tribes' attacks come from Ecuador. Two groups of Indians keep everyone in fear, the Tagaeri and the Taramanane. In the 21st century, when the tourists can fly into space, you can sail down the river, stop and get killed just because you are on their land. Yes, it's normal. It's normal, my friends. It's something ordinary, so we have very interesting adventures ahead of us. The way from the city to the settlement is very long. So the Indians use every chance to buy all the necessary stuff for their tribe. Cereal, sugar, salt, eggs, canned goods, pasta. Everything that's impossible to get in the jungle. Yes, the modern Huaorani eat such food too. But of course, we can't come to the village empty-handed. So today we're shopping for the gifts for the whole tribe. Let's go together and buy the most needed and the most interesting things. Machete. First of all, machete. How many do you need? About 15. Is this your main working tool? Yes, we need this to gather yucca, cut the trees, make the hunting blowpipes. Before we used machetes during the battles. You aren't going to kill anyone with these now, right? If you're not, then I will buy them. What else do you need? Some bowls. The Indians ordered the bowls, the sharpeners for machetes, some knives and fishing tackle. So the hunting and the fishing, nothing has changed in the thousands of years. We bought everything for the male business. Now it's time to think about women. How many women are there in your village? 37. We want to buy some pots for our older women. And what about the younger ones? I don't even know. Imagine you can take anything for free. What would you take? It's impressive how modest the people are. In any other tribe, if they were allowed to take anything they wanted, they'd take the half of the goods here. And these people are thinking it over. It's just Dad has never been in a situation when he could get anything he wanted. What else do you need? The lanterns, the toilet paper, the toys. I don't know, maybe some dishes? We can take the toys for the kids and the bottles for the girls to carry water. Go ahead and choose. So you choose the bottles. Do you drink water from the river? Yes, we do. Look at this bottle. Why don't you want to take it? It costs $4. Too expensive. I'm so impressed. I see you are noble people. You are not greedy. And you care about the other people's money too. We are not used to having money. So we treat it thriftily. We never take anything extra. We only buy the most necessary things. We'll take some volleyballs and soccer balls for the kids and a lot of stuffed toys so everybody could get one. It's interesting that they use American dollars here. There is no national currency in Ecuador. You get dollars in the ATMs and in the banks. The tribes use dollars too. So, Huaorani people, are you happy now? Yes. Will you let me be your guest? Yes. You won't kill me, right? We won't. I know you have 15 machetes now, by the way. This can be our protection all the way through the non-contact tribes lands to fight if they attack. I doubt it will help. They use spears. Do you travel armed?
No.
Well, someone might think not taking their weapons going on such a dangerous trip is a real suicide. But if you take the gun, you must be ready to shoot and kill. I know all the risks, but I cannot even think about doing such thing myself. Yes, the non-contact Indians are cruel, but we are invading their land, not the vice versa. We are going there to study and not to disturb anyone. So to protect ourselves, we must be careful, observant, trust our good feelings, and most importantly, our guides' experience and knowledge. The next day, we are ready to leave. It's morning in Coca, my friends. We are starting our expedition to the Huaorani tribe, which is considered one of the most cruel in the world. We'll get to know these savage people. The cars are already here. Buenos dias. Hi. Hi. How are you today? Fine. Is it a long way to go? About 2 or 2.5 hours to the boat station. Then we'll go down the river. Here is the car with our stuff, and another car with a group of Indians. They are our guides and bodyguards. You'll see everything for yourself soon. The adventure is about to start. Let's go. We've already left the city. Now we're in the jungle, where a nice asphalted road has been built. And it's much more than just a road through the jungle. It won't be an exaggeration to say this road has completely changed the life of the Huaorani, who are we about to meet. 70 years ago, there was the impassable jungle here, where the cruel and warlike Indians lived. They didn't let anyone on their land. People stayed away from them out of fear. Maybe they would still be hiding in the jungle if the massive deposits of oil weren't found in this area. The first contacts of the Huaorani with the outer world happened after the oil deposits were discovered here. Of course, the active oil development has started then. But all the people who came to this jungle in the search of oil were killed without a warning. The situation was very complicated. The Huaorani didn't let the oilmen enter their land, but the oilmen didn't stop as huge money was at stake. A real war has started. The situation seemed dire. How can you negotiate with people who don't accept any reasons and don't hesitate to kill? The first attempts has started to convert the Huaorani into Christianity and to explain to them the main commandment, thou shalt not kill. They managed to make arrangements with several Huaorani groups. They became contact, they come to the city, wear jeans and get an education. But there are still groups which refuse to make contact and kill anyone who steps on their land. I'll jump ahead and tell you, these are not just scary stories about some mystical savages. During this expedition, we'll meet many witnesses and even victims of such attacks. Moreover, we'll meet the murderers themselves. But the road we're taking now has actually opened the way for the oil production in Ecuadorian Amazonia. Ironically, it's called Via Auca, which means the road of savages. Look. There is a car which belongs to the oil company, so this region lives off of the oil. If you look at the map, it becomes clear that Via Auca is not just the road connecting the cities. It's an industrial highway built in the wild jungle with the oil production sites situated nearby. There are many of them already, and more of them appear every year. there are pillars of fire coming out of the jungle. You can see these very often in the tropical forests of Ecuador. The oil production occurs on a massive scale. More and more oil is being produced, and this process will hardly stop. When I was a kid, I walked in the forest freely. I could walk even here. But everything has developed with the time. There are more and more fences, borders, closing rears. We are being herded into small reservations where it's very hard to live. I see more and more dead animals in different places. Tapirs, snakes, birds, various mammals. The situation becomes worse for the nature. How do you see the future of this region? It can end with a disaster. What disaster? First of all, we can disappear, as we fully depend on the forest. The animals and plants will die, the new disease will appear, and it will affect the whole world, not just us. It hurts me to see all this, as it clearly illustrates how people interfere into the life of the nature and change the regular course of the natural processes. The jungle is being destroyed. The places where the wild forest used to provide habitat for many animals have turned into the oil production site. The forest is the home for us and the animals. It gives us oxygen and humidity. If it disappears, will disappear too. This wet tropical forest in Amazonia area provides a lot of oxygen. Each tree evaporates a great amount of moisture, which rains down on these forests later. If the forest disappears, there's going to be a desert here someday. For Ginto, fighting the oil industry is a part of his own family story. In 2 hours, when we arrived to the boat station, he shared his memories about the regular conflicts between the Huaorani and the oil man. When I was a kid, my parents killed everyone who came to destroy the forest or produce the oil. The kids often had to kill the wounded. So you count the times when people were killed? Yes, I saw it very often. I'll tell you about it later. Let's get ready. We'll get into the boats now to sail down the river. It's good that the water level has risen after the rain. We can move faster. We are still to find out why the rising of the water level is a good sign. Here it affects not only the speed, but also the safety along the way. Here are the boats we will take to get to the Huaorani village. I can feel the adventure in the air, and I'm sure the trip will not be boring. How much fuel do we need? There are 60 gallons here. We have 4 such barrels for our expedition. Now I understand why the Indians do not come to the city very often. It's expensive, about a ton of fuel for 2 boats. While we were loading the barrels with fuel, it started raining again. The weather in Amazonian jungle is very changeable. We must take our raincoats out. Everyone's getting ready. Only the Indians remain calm. There will be some changes during the expedition. During the Ukrainian season, we have started walking with 2 cameras on a regular basis. So our old friend Sasha Shiloh is here with us today. You remember him well. He has helped us when there was a need to substitute for Sasha Dmytro, who injured his leg in Nepal. He has also helped us to film an episode about the bottom side of the film industry in Brazil. Now we're 2 operators traveling with us. You'll see even more unbelievable footage and atmosphere. Let's go. But before we begin our journey, we must show our vaccination passports. Here, the coronavirus vaccine, AstraZeneca, 2 doses. Here's my vaccination passport. Here I have all the vaccines possible. Look, diphtheria, typhoid fever, tetanus, hepatitis A and B. Here is the yellow fever. So basically, I have every vaccine in Sasha too. You can't even get to visit the tribe without a vaccine. You must get vaccinated, my friend. I have a question. Are you vaccinated against coronavirus? Yes, we are all vaccinated. Did the state get even the most remote tribes vaccinated? Yes. Wow. All the vaccination passports have been checked. We can load our stuff now. Here. Here. And now bend down. Toilet paper. Do Huaorani use toilet paper? This is for you. Ah, for us, thank you. I thought, oh really, there are plenty of leaves. Why do we need gas? To cook on the way. It might be hard to fix a fire when it's raining. We've never had such an expedition to visit the tribes with gas before. Why do we need a gas chainsaw? Big trees fall into the river sometimes and block the way, so you have to cut them while moving down the river. What did you do when you didn't have the chainsaw? We waited for the river to rise. Finally, our luggage is packed and loaded into the boat. Let's get acquainted. What's your name? Mauricio. I'll manage the boat on our way to Bameno. Wilson. I'll cook. We are lucky to have a cook on board. Hello, charming lady. What's your name? Celia. I'm going the same way. I'm returning home to Bameno with my kids. Two little cuties. They're Justin and Ray. We'll need to go through the territories of the non-contact tribes, so we'll need more people in our group. When these tribes see a large number of people, they usually don't attack. And you, young man? Namo. I'll manage the other boat. So everyone is ready and we are departing. I'm putting my hood on, as I think I'll spend the next 10 hours soaking wet. But it will be very, very interesting. Well, 10 hours was an optimistic guess. We have an unpredictable way ahead of us. The journey time depends on the water level and on how the things will go in the expedition. It can take us a few days to get there. Our team will go down this twist river, Shiripuno, to get the most distant Huaorani settlement, Bameno. Kinta, why could it be dangerous to go by boat? You might hit a sunken log or get aground. But the worst thing is that we might get stuck in the non-contact tribe's territory. Where is this place and how far is it? It will take about 6 hours. Is it really that dangerous? Can they hide in the forest so we don't see them and then attack us or shoot at us? Yes, if the water is low or if we stop in their territory and go ashore, they can attack us. In fact, the Tagueri are a kind of Huaorani too, but they don't want any contacts with the outer world and are ready to kill anyone who sets foot on their land. Is there a delimitation of the territory? Yes, and we try not to violate their boundaries. We never enter their lands. We can only pass through their territory quickly by water. Is it some kind of unspoken arrangement? Yes, and the Tagueri, in their turn, try not to come close to our settlements, which are situated around their lands. They know you can find one of the modern villages if you walk for 2 or 3 days. I remember our conflicts with the Tagueri since I was a kid. Sometimes they accidentally walked on the roads built by the oil companies. These roads have led them to civilization. When meeting people there, the Tagueri started to attack and got killed for that. So these tribes have decided not to have any contacts with the civilization and are now living in their secluded world. How old are you? As always, the people in the tribes don't remember it. He's trying to remember, at least approximately. His documents say he's 66. Older people don't remember their age or the date of birth. The Huaorani have a different calendar based on some natural events like harvest, etc. Dad was born in Chonte. It's when the peach palm ripens, somewhere in April. So they put an approximate date of birth in his passport. So you were born in the middle of the 50s. Were you also the non-contact Huaorani? Yes, when I was a kid, we led a quiet life in the forest. We hunted and gathered yucca, but one day we heard some strange noise in the sky. And the voices. That was when I first saw a plane. We were very scared. We cast the spears to hit it. My parents were terrified. They thought it was a monster or a ghost, which we call paramuaya. The voices speaking Huaorani were heard from that thing. They said they came in peace and wanted to help us. Only when we saw a man sitting on that plane, we understood it was not a monster. Imagine that, my friends. Not so long ago, in the 70s, our parents have already used their planes to travel. And this man saw a plane for the first time and got scared. His whole family thought it was a ghost. When did you first find out there were other people except the Huaorani? I don't remember exactly. I guess when I was about 20 or 22. I met a stranger in another village and she told me there were other people, other nationalities who speak different languages. She even offered me a job in the city if I went with her. How did you react when you learned there were other people on the planet? It came as a big surprise for us. Different people, different way of life. We live in the forest, everything is common here, and they had their own things. How did you adapt to the new realities? We didn't even realize how that happened. But the girl from our tribe, Dayuma, and the American missionaries helped us a great deal. They told us how to live in the modern world. They said we had to wear city clothes instead of being naked if we didn't want people to be afraid of us and think we're savages and to behave appropriately. Who are you shouting to? Our distant relative lives here. The Huaorani's relatives live here too. It was funny when he passed the house and shouted, "Oh, whoa!" and they responded to him. That meant there's someone in the house. So, my friends, after talking to Ginto, I can make the main conclusion, which is really unique for me. Yes, our ancestors used to go around naked too, but it took them thousands of years to become modern people. Here we see an example of super fast evolution. When was your life better? When you didn't know what a plane was and ran around the jungle naked as a young boy, or now when you can go to the city stores, use the mobile phone, and buy anything you want. I have lived a pretty long life and I can tell you that it was better before. Yes, we didn't have shops and markets and the variety of food, but the whole forest was ours and it gave us everything we needed. Of course, a lot of things are available now, but there are more complications too. You have to travel a lot to earn money, to do something to survive in the modern world. So you support the choice of the people who hide somewhere in this forest and don't let anyone come near them. A lot of Arab people will tell you that it's better to stay in the jungle instead of going to the city. Well, and that's understandable. Look how beautiful it is here, the Andes jungle of Amazonia. It's a totally different and fantastic world. There are flocks of parents flying by, the jaguars who are hiding in the impassable jungle, the caimans and anacondas you can see in the river. This virgin nature is really amazing. We were admiring the nature and didn't even notice the end of the day. It's getting dark. Where will we spend the night? Actually, we plan to reach the shelter in the jungle. We need a few hours to get there, but our second boat has fallen behind, so we must stop somewhere and wait for them. While we were talking to the guides, I didn't even notice that our second boat has disappeared from sight. It's getting dark, but they're still not here. Let's make a stop here at the beach. Are there non-contact tribes here? No, they live far away from here. What's that sound? I'm calling our second boat. He gives them our geolocation. That's how the navigation works in the Amazonian forest in Ecuador. How do you do that? Let's try together. It's ooh, not oh. You do it with your vocal cords and you need to blow like a pipe. Let's try again. Imagine you are sending your voice far away. We learned to do it since childhood. Get up, boss. Let's shout together. Our people have fallen behind. Ooh.
my friends, the phone doesn't work. Here, look, there's no connection, so we just have to shout. I assume they have fallen really far behind. Let's use the modern technologies. Let's try, maybe the transmitter will work. Our shouting didn't help. Boat 2, come in, over. It works only a mile away. The direct visibility is necessary too, so I'm not sure it'll work out. Boat 2, come in, over. Come in, over. There is no connection, so they are still far away. The situation is getting more serious. Anything could happen to them in the darkness. We send the boat back, as we really need to find our friends. Now we are left without transport in the small beach in the middle of the jungle of Ecuador. Looks like we might not make it to the shelter tonight, so we'll have to spend the night at the beach. How do you like being left in the middle of the jungle in Ecuador at night? I don't mind, I like nature. We're optimists, of course, but in reality, staying in the middle of the jungle at night without food and tents, not knowing where the rest of the team is now, is not really the best prospect, to put it mildly. Luckily, we heard the sounds of engines from afar, and then saw the boats. They have been found. It turned out the second boat had some problems with the engine. Finally, everyone is here. We will set up a camp now. Frankly speaking, it's not the best place to spend the night. The water level is rising. It can start raining any minute and the beach will be flooded. We need a shed. I'll go to get some branches. Let me help you with that. We'll take the second machete. Let's go. It's slavery. That's what the tropical jungle of Ecuador really looks like, my friends. There are no tourists here, there are no paths, no civilization. People do not live here. These trees are good for the shed. I will cut these. My friends, the laws of jungle work here. Of course, I'm against the deforestation, but here you either kill or be killed. If you spend the night in the jungle, you need to prepare a place to sleep. These are the laws of survival. Yes, we'll need to cut a few trees now, but not more than we need. We don't cut the trees massively. We take as much as we need to survive. Sasha, help us if you want a nice place to sleep. And the real Indians don't need machetes. Our second boatman got some branches for us with simian agility. We started late today. We had to start an hour and a half before the sunset. It's good, we have lanterns. Everything is wet after the rain. Here's what spending the night in the jungle looks like. Not romantic at all. Besides, there are a lot of insects here. Sasha, look, a cricket. The jungle is one of corners of the planet replete in the wildlife. If you come here, you must wear long-sleeved clothes. Because except the harmless crickets, there are many deadly insects and spiders here. If you are not lucky, you might not come back from the jungle alive. Enough chatting. We need more leaves for our hut. They will help us to keep the warmth. We'll put them on the ground. Never spent the night like this. So, what happened here while we were in the forest? Wow! He's cooking the chicken, his rice, and water. Look, he used some gas, and now a good meal is being cooked. Cool! That's what the modern tribes are like. While our meal is being cooked, we'll build a shed for the night. It's pretty simple. Four sticks, a tent, some leaves to cover the ground, and our shed is ready. We have to get it down quickly so we can go to sleep, as the water level is rising, and we can have a surprise here at night. See the water? I'll draw the line, and we'll see how fast it gets here. We might be flooded here. We might, or we definitely will. It's nature. Nobody knows for sure. If the water comes very close, we'll need to get out of here quickly. It's all about the rain. We saw the downpour in another region. There's a lot of water now. Now it comes down the stream and this place is about to be flooded. Only 5 or 7 minutes have passed and the line I drew is already covered with water. Look, the water is rising very quickly. It's getting closer. I doubt we'll get any sleep tonight. But at least we'll have a good dinner. Thanks. Cool. Such a nice meal in filled conditions. How do you say bon appétit in Huaorani? We just say kinimpa. It means food. Kinimpa. Kinimpa. When I was preparing for this trip, I read a lot about your community and your tribe. I learned some horrifying information. You are called aggressive and cruel, especially the non-contact tribes. That's true. In 2016, the non-contacts killed our relatives in Arana. They mixed them up with someone else from the city because they wore modern clothes. Why were they attacked? Only because they wore modern clothes. Maybe it was an act of revenge, as their settlement was attacked 3 years before that. And when they saw a couple in the modern clothes near the river, they thought these were people who attacked their settlement, so they decided to take revenge. I must explain something here. Our boatman has mentioned in the modern Indians attacking and non-contact tribes in 2013. The news was caused a stir in Ecuador. I'm talking about the most known massive attack in the last years. These 20 non-contact Indians were killed then. Everyone was shocked with the fact that the attackers were modern Indians. Nobody had expected the civilized Huaorani to return to their old habit, the blood revenge. By destroying the whole settlement, they took revenge for the death of their tribal elders, Ampore and Bugane. That's why the boatman thinks the murder at the river was also an act of revenge. It happens just recently, so the blood revenge still exists. Back in the city, you told me that you're asserting the right to kill on the legislative level. If someone offends me, I can take a revenge and kill him. It's normal for us. So the young people studied the laws to unite these two worlds. What internal laws not acknowledged by the state do you have? After that attack in 2013, the state put everyone who participated into the jail without looking into the matter. The state laws don't correspond with the Huaorani traditions, which existed long before the state even appeared. We want our traditions to be taken into the consideration before we are sued. In other words, even the modern Huaorani think that they have every right to take revenge and kill. In the 21st century, it sounds absolutely ridiculous. Considering the recent murder, does it mean there is a possibility that any of us can get killed while traveling here? We don't have contacts with the Tagereri and the Taramanari, but they still have a tradition of blood revenge. So yes, it can happen. To them, we are different. We look differently. We wear clothes. We don't wear the discs in our ears. So I always say we must be careful while traveling through their lands by water. The most important thing is to go through the non-contact zone as quickly as possible. You can't even stop to pee if you are in the area where they live, because we don't know who might be hiding behind the trees. I feel it's going to be a hard day tomorrow. Thanks for the delicious dinner. First of all, I'd like to thank the cook. Look, we're going to drown. Oh my God, the water is already here. It's here. When we started to eat, the water was 2 meters from here. Look at this. Wow. I think it might not be possible to spend the night here. What are we doing now? What's the plan? I think we must take the boats and move on. We'll try to get to the camp where we planned to spend the night. Sure, let's go. It's really dangerous and risky to sail down the river at night. It's very twisty. You can't see anything. The boatman is by the stern, so Miguel is standing at the front of the boat to warn about the possible obstacles on time. In the darkness, you can easily run into a sunken log, turn the boat over, get your stuff drowned, and meet the dangerous inhabitants of the local waters. A crocodile! A crocodile! Luckily, we finally reach our shelter. Wow, fantastic. The wooden stairs, what is this? It's an abandoned tourist camp, a nice place to spend the night. Wow, it's a real house. Or rather, a big terrace. That's where we will sleep. In the morning, we were able to look around the place where we came at night. Morning. There is a complex of cabins. The roof is rusty. Looking around, you can tell this place used to be touristic. It was decorated. There are flowers around. Here's an abandoned guest house. It's time to pack our stuff and move on. Poland. We've been sailing down the river for almost 2 days now. We want to know the Huaorani tribe better. Honestly, I have some mixed feelings. On one hand, I really like to meet the non-contact Huaorani, but on the other hand, I really want to live. It's a natural desire of every human, so I'd like to meet them on condition that I stay alive and go on with the shooting. The landscape didn't change in half an hour, but our guide's mood has suddenly changed. They had clearly tensed up and became alert. We were entering the non-contact tribe zone. There are two places where people have been attacked recently. Is this one of them? Yes. A friend of mine, Manuel Kawe, was traveling here with his two colleagues. They stopped to bail out the boat. Suddenly, he noticed some Indians with spears running towards them. The men cast spears at them from one side of the river, and women were standing on the other side, shouting angrily. It happened right here, my friends. Where were the men and the women? Women were on that side, and men on this side. There used to be a beach. And how many men and women? About 10 men and 15 women and kids. Manuel has jumped into the water. One of the spears hit him in the back. He was lucky not to get pierced with it. At that moment, the boatman took out the gun and shot into the air. It frightened the Indians and they ran away. Was anyone killed then? No, all three men were just injured. One of them started swinging his arms, trying to prevent the Indians from attacking. The spear hit him in the arm, pierced it, and hit his chest too. What do you feel when you travel here? We always feel uneasy. We look around and listen to all the sounds and noises attentively. We try not to stop here, and we never go ashore. Does this area still stay the non-contact tribe zone, or did the territory swift nowadays? No, this is their territory. They are still here. They live in different places. Up there and here, closer to the river. So in theory, they can be somewhere out there. And see us now. Or maybe there. Yes. Somewhere in the jungle, there are people who can attack us. For some of you, it may sound like a fairy tale or a movie plot, but it's true. And here are the living people who can confirm it. A researcher from Brazil, José Carlos Meirelles, has also told us about the non-contact tribes' attacks. He barely survived after one of these attacks. And a year after our conversation, the non-contact tribes from the same Amazonian forest had shot his colleague with a bow. It was all over the news. Traveling through the non-contact territory is really dangerous. Start the engine, we must get out of here. I feel uneasy here. You can't stay here for a long time. We need to pass this place as quickly as possible. The world inside out. In the next episode, we'll continue our dangerous journey through the territory of the tribes, which have never contacted the civilization. They can kill 2, 4, or 8 people, actually. We are unarmed. They must already know we are here on their land. We'll find those who survived after the attacks. There was blood everywhere. I managed to jump into the boat, start the engine, and escape. will find his scary artifacts. Here is your son's blood. When they took the spear out, there were pieces of flesh on the tip. We'll learn more about what the non-contact tribes are like nowadays. They decorate their spears with feathers and a sloth hair. They look stronger and more muscular than us. It seems the bullets didn't hit the non-contacts. We'll meet people who have arrived for the blood revenge, according to Huaorani laws. Sometimes I really want to use this spear. Do you really know how to find them? The World Inside Out with Dmytro.